Johnny Hockey recording a career-high 6 points in a game that saw the Flames score 6 goals in the third period alone to lay the smackdown on the Devils a little bit at the end of that game?
Yeah, that was not pretty for the Devils in the third period. And usually when people, when a guy like Johnny Hockey puts on a clinic, there's not another NHL team on the ice. But wow. That's a lot of pucks.
It's the first time a player has had 6 points in a game since 2013. So big night for Johnny G.
Oh, it was one of the it was him in a nutshell dominating the entire night. And you'll see, like, there's nights that he has where everything feels so good. And in the past, 19 games, I think he'd only scored once.
Yeah.
He'd been struggling. But all of a sudden, things come together, and it started right here where, I mean, that's a beautiful pass by Sean Monahan. But what you'll notice is Gaudreau is able to get it in so tight and so close to the goalie, he just opens up the leg, slides it in 5-hole. So that was first. And the pickup of this pass
is
the best part.
You know what I love? When he attacks the middle of the ice all the time, and that's so important. But
look at that.
That's not easy, right?
That is, like, to do that at full speed, I know it doesn't look that crazy, but the speed and the level of skill it takes to pull that off and then still get the chance from he gets the penalty shot and buries that one. So this was a night where I think his legs felt light and the hands felt quick.
Oh, yeah, he was flying. Here's a 2-on-1 opportunity. Connor Carrick, really no chance here if you're going to play it that way. He tries to get him with the stick, but as soon as he moves the stick, Whit, that's the signal to Johnny Hockey. Just throw it across, and Ryan does a good job. Just puts the stick on the ice, in.
Yep. And this one right here, I think you see his speed off the wing. He's not afraid to go to the net. Another beautiful pass by Monahan, who actually held up and waited to give it to him. And then this one, I mean, this is when it's like, oh, my God, this game's so easy to this guy. How is he doing this? And then everyone ends up going to him. Everyone's looking at the puck, and the guy's wide open and Gaudreau. I mean, you see the head up the entire time. He knows what he's doing, tight little turns, and then he figures, someone will be open. And that's just poor D-zone coverage for the Devils.
Yeah, it looked a little like Gretzky there with that turn back, holding on to the puck, and he's having a great season. And you know, recently it's been a little bit of a struggle for him. Only 10 points in his last 17 games. 6 points in one game last night. So I'd say
give
he's back on
boost.
I'd say he's back on track.
Give him a little boost.
That's
he's
the
in the
night
top five now.
The night he needed.
Yes,
he
did.
Yes, his
one.
Line, by the way, the line of Gaudreau, Monahan, and Lindholm combines for 14 points. Woo! On the night. Oh, my goodness.
But I love I just love the fact that Johnny Hockey, even with, he's not the biggest guy, but he attacks the middle of the ice because that's what you want to do. If you're a defender, you did it for many years. What do you want
to
do?
Keep him to the outside.
Push him out there by the boards. He's not afraid. He attacks the middle of the ice, and he does it with regularity, and he's successful at it most of the time.
Yep. We know Kucherov's the runaway favorite for the Hart. Does Johnny Hockey deserve a little love, though, in that competition?
He might be a finalist. We'll see how things go down the stretch. There's a couple of guys that'll be in the mix. I think it will be Kucherov winning it, but I can see Johnny Gaudreau being a finalist.
Just getting a little kudos.
The Kucherov season has been so incredible because the real race is like, who would be the other two finalists?
That's right.
There's so many different options.
Yeah, who can hang around?
Definitely deserves it.
Yeah.
I agree. You guys wanted to take a look at a play by the Devils, though, as well. Losing effort, but you want to look
at it. Yeah, I mean, it was a tough night for the Devils, but early on, they were in the game for two periods, and Blake Coleman ends up scoring a goal here. This is his 20th of the season, so good for Blake. He's having a great year. But I like what Kyle Palmieri does. It's just a little thing here, and you know how this goes, right? He's ahead of the defender. He just stops up on him, so you're not going to get to Coleman. That's teamwork. That's really helping your teammate out.
And it's also, it's not interference because that's Palmieri's ice as much as it is Giordano.
Exactly.
So if you're just getting his way, well, I'm not doing anything. You just happen to be behind me. So a great play. And Coleman gets his 20th. Real good season for
good
him.
Yeah, good for him.
In a tough night, you think Mackenzie Blackwood was in for all nine. So he's probably, it's a tough
Rough morning.
Day that.
Rough morning for him. Let's start with the alley-oop pass, because both of you guys were ranting and raving when you walked into the meeting this morning.
This play is so good, and we saw it just the other night. Nick Dowd did it in Washington, but this one by Justin Schultz. I mean, it's just incredible to see these players landed in the exact spot you need to land. It's like hitting a little 60-degree wedge at 30 yards. And the fact that Crosby's able to beat Kempney, skate into that one. Ege, you were mentioning, I think Holtby would probably play this one a little differently.
Yeah, he went for the cross check, and I don't really know. I guess he probably thought that maybe Sid was not going to have a play there. But it's Sidney Crosby. I mean, you can see there again, one of the great players, and he's able to make something out of it looks like a situation where he's not going to be able to get a shot. And it was odd to me that Holtby reacted with kind of coming up and trying to maybe protect himself, but also make contact with Crosby instead of staying low. I mean, if he just, you know, takes away the bottom of the net, that puck's just going to hit him and he's going to cover it up. So I think you're right. I think if he looks at the tape of that, he probably wishes he played it a different way. But it's a play that happened so fast that caught him by surprise.
Yeah, and Crosby skated into it perfectly. That was one of the top passes of the year, and we've seen two of them now in the past couple of days.
I know.
Yeah, Sid was fired up after that goal, too. I can't repeat what I think he was saying, but...
Yeah.
Last year, Ege, during the Stanley Cup playoffs, you talked a lot about Kuznetsov in that series against Pittsburgh and how important he was and how crucial he was to the Caps finally being able to get past them. Last night, though, not as there was a couple moments in the game.
Yeah, just a couple of things that I didn't think he was at his best, and I think it ended up hurting the Washington Capitals. Now, it's 2-0 when this occurs in the second period. Now, he gets the puck here, and he's going to be able to get the puck, and now he's got time. Let's just chip it and get it out of the zone, but he's taking too much time. And Jared McCann comes in, just steals the puck from him, picks his pocket, and goes the other way. I think he could have just chipped this into space and let Connolly skate into it, and you're off the other way. Instead, he's too deliberate, not moving his feet, not going straight up the ice. McCann picks his pocket and makes a nice play to Guentzel.
And McCann can wheel, too.
Yeah.
This is late in the game, and you're looking to tie it up. He kind of just throws it blindly. That wasn't as bad as the first clip, but, you know, you still see a guy who didn't look, as into the game as I think a lot of other guys were. I mean, maybe physically, mentally, just kind of never got involved the way he needed to be. And I think that first clip shows it more than anything. I know you mentioned maybe chipping it into open ice. For me, I understand why he's not chipping it, because he's a playmaker, wants to make plays. But I think that if Todd Reardon's looking at that, he's like, you just got to get your feet going.
Yeah, get your feet going.
I mean, he got that puck.
And he went sideways.
And he's so skilled that most of the time he can wait and look people off. Yeah. That time he's just not going anywhere. Yeah. So, and McCann can wheel, like we said.
Right.
And then he, turns it, makes a great pass over to, I think it was Guentzel. But Kuznetsov, it's funny. Last year they were able to win the cup because he did take that. He got to that next level. And all of a sudden you have Backstrom and him. It's Crosby, Malkin, the one that stand the cups. You need those two centers to play great hockey. And he was last year. I think he'll be great again. It was just an off night.
Yeah.
Which happens. We're going to welcome Michael Grabner onto
there
the show right now.
I'm sure he's howling.
I'm sure he just heard you howling. So, Michael, I'm going to start with the howl. I'm sure you just heard it. How would you rate EJ's howl?
It was pretty good. I have a lot of coyotes in my back, so I can't keep up with them. So it's pretty good.
I can howl with the best of them, Michael.
Yeah, it sounded pretty good.
It's too good. Well, listen, you guys wake up today. You're in a playoff spot. It's going to be a fight down all the way to the final game of the season, probably. What's the mindset in the locker room right now?
I don't think our mindset has changed in the last, 2-3 months. Obviously, I just started playing again, but from being around the guys, it was just a day-by-day, game-by-game kind of mindset we've got going, and it's been working for us the last couple of months here, so we're not going to change anything what we do and how we prepare.
Michael, I was reading Elliot Friedman's 31 Thoughts column today, and in it he talks a lot about a conversation he had with you about your recovery from a very significant eye injury you had early in the year. You're back playing now, which is great. But in reading that, it sounded like you were very fearful that you were really never going to, maybe would never play again.
Yeah, obviously, it's a tough time there. It's a weird injury to happen. And, you never know how things progress or how they heal with an eye. Obviously, I talked to some of the guys that had eye injuries before, but it kept me pretty positive. And I just tried to skate, train, work out, and keep myself in shape to see when the eye comes back and it heals to that point where I can play. And last week, I felt like it was good enough to give it a shot, and it worked pretty good. So I'm happy I'll be back out there with the guys and be around the team more now, and hopefully I can help the push for the playoffs here.
I think it's huge for the team to get you back and your penalty killing and your speed. And we were talking just the other day when you guys lost to Chicago the other night. Rick Tocchet said after that he kind of took the blame for the loss. As a player, what is it like for you to see that and see, all right, well, the coach is really putting his neck out on the line for us? And is that kind of what went into you guys responding so well against St. Louis?
Yeah, I think we haven't had too many bad games here. I think it's not just on him. Obviously, it's nice to see him take some of the blame, but I think you got to be ready to play. And yeah, that was just one of those games you kind of flush down the toilet and want to forget about as quick as you can. So it was nice to have another game the next night and get back on track. And that's what we did. And that's what the guys been doing since I've been out. When I watched the games, they didn't let any of those bad moments stick around, and they just kind of kept a short memory and got right back to it. So that's what we did last night.
Darcy Kuemper has been so big for you guys lately. What is he like as a teammate?
Oh, he's great. He's a funny guy. He's always talking in the room and stuff, so it's great to have him around, and it's nice to see him have the success that he has had in the last couple months here. So he's definitely stepped up his game and rose his game to the next challenge. And yeah, it's great to see him. He's a great guy to have around, so it's nice to see.
Michael, with your speed, you have been one of the really high-end penalty killers in this league for a long time. This group of penalty killers in Arizona has been, I mean, you guys have been dangerous. I mean, you guys have been scoring goals with the down a man in games. What's the mindset of that group of penalty killers? Why are you guys so good this year?
I don't know. It's a tough question. Yeah, we're just trying to kill it 2 minutes off, and I don't think anyone is cheating out there for offense, and we just stick to our system that we have in place. And yeah, we're just getting some turnovers, and guys are not panicking when they have the puck in a penalty kill and trying to make plays if they're there. And if they're not, we're just trying to get the puck down the ice. So we've been pretty consistent in the penalty kill this year, and we're going to need that for the last 12 games here too.
I actually had dinner with an old teammate of yours, Taylor Hall, last night, and he mentioned to me that you were the best card player he's ever played against. Would you read like a Doyle Brunson book, or how'd you get so good at cards?
I don't know. I just trying to play the players, I guess. it's just fun to play some cards and loosen up a little bit on those plane rides, especially here. We have some long ones. So, yeah, but I think Taylor, he learned a couple tricks from me. I think he won a couple of games this year, he said.
Hey, you know, Michael, we showed that photograph of when you got injured there with the eye, but, you know, aside from the injury, which was awful, and we're glad you're back, that mustache, I mean, you even said the stash is intact. That was serious. That was no joke. I mean, you going to bring that back?
I don't know. I kept it for a while there, but then I kind of just shaved it off to get rid of the memory of the injury and kind of start over. So probably have to wait till next November to come back.
All right, fair enough.
That's a good one.
It is a good
That's
one.
A good
it
mustache.
Is a good one.
A good
listen, good luck down the stretch here with the Yotes, and thanks for taking the time today. We appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Thanks for having me.
We saw a few two-on-ones last night with that you guys kind of wanted to take a look at.
Yeah, I mean, looking at that one we just saw with Joe Pavelski putting that in, I mean, that was great execution by the San Jose Sharks in that particular case. This is the Johnny Gaudreau play from last night against the Devils wit. And again, really good execution.
Great execution. Then you get a look at the Pavelski one right here. Beautiful sauce pass by Timo Meier. We're kind of going to talk about the defenders, and as good as those plays are, you kind of need a little bit more from your defender playing a two-on-one. And the main issue being that you can't let the pass get across.
And both times those passes went through.
Both times, you know, they get across. And the issue is you're going against some really high-skilled players. I've seen times with Sidney Crosby, no matter what you do, he will find a hole that the puck fits through.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Sometimes you have to tip your cap, but there's a lot of other times where two-on-ones can be played better. So if we're going to look at one right now, right, we'll say for the first one, Jackie's carrying it down.
Sure.
I think what first you want to kind of look at as a defender and realize is which way the person shoots right now. So if Jackie's a lefty coming down, that means that her stick isn't to the inside. You know, it's a better angle for the goalie. She doesn't have as good of an angle shooting. So you can be a little more lazy in terms of, like, letting her get the shot. You're more confident that your goalie's going to stop that shot. You can
push her wide.
You can push her wide, and then her stick gets even wider being a lefty. And then if she does try to drag it into the middle, I'm kind of there with a good stick.
Yeah.
And all of this is going on while I'm making sure you're not getting it.
That's right.
It's like I'm doing that.
And you have to know if I'm a righty or if I'm a lefty.
Exactly.
Because if I'm a righty, it's different than if I'm a lefty, where I can kind of now catch it back here more and it makes it harder for you to defend that pass.
Yeah, so you don't really realize usually how much it matters which way the players shoot. Yeah. If we were to then bring it over here, you know what I mean, yeah. just the opposite of Jackie, now I'm thinking, all right, well, EJ's got a perfect angle to shoot. His stick's in the middle of the ice. I still don't want to let him move it across, but I have to be more careful of, you know, not giving him a full-blown
yes.
chance, right?
Yeah.
Now, the thing is that I see, like, the Devils play it a different way, where the Devils want to just give the goalie the shooter. They'll look at it like, all right, goalie, that's almost a one-on-one breakaway. I'm going to just take Jackie away. There's no chance the puck's going across. Goalie, you worry about your guy. What happened there? You see, yeah, I think it was Connor Carrick, was it?
Yes.
And you know what? He's doing his best. He had an active stick. He's trying to, you know, make sure that the player thinks that he may attack them, the puck carrier. But Johnny Gaudreau, one of the best players in the league, makes this perfect pass where you see Derek Ryan, it just hits his stick. That's sometime you got to tip your cap. The other thing is, though, if I'm playing against you, it doesn't matter who has the puck in this instance, I want to make sure that I'm taking away the pass, but I don't want to give you a completely free ride.
Yeah.
So it's a fake of going over there maybe uh-huh. and then making sure you go back. But more than anything, if the pass gets across, the goalie has almost no chance. He has to make what will be a save of the year candidate
yes.
for our show.
Sure. Yeah.
But the issue being that if the goalie has the shooter, at least he has a chance to stop that guy one-on-one. And in his mind, more than anything, I'm not worried about it getting across.
So you're trying to, like, process a ton of information as this is happening. So how crucial is it that the defenseman doesn't hesitate on the decision?
I think it's very important. I think the defenseman having an active stick and making you think I might go to you as the puck carrier, but also being in a position to take away a pass. And that's why people argue, do you go down? Do people like when you lay down? Now, I never was a fan of it because if a player's really skilled and he stops up, you're sliding into the corner.
Yes.
And then it's a 2-on-0. Yeah. Maybe a back checker comes back. But I like trying to stay on my feet. There's some people that master the ability to go down at the perfect time, block the pass, block the shot. But there's different ways to play it. But more than anything, I think any coach, any player will say, just don't let them go through you. Don't let them go through your triangle and give, you know, for your case, Jackie, an open net. Because the goalie can do nothing.
I hear a lot of times when I talk to Dano and Larry Robinson in years past, they are big fans of staying on their feet.
Yeah.
Stick on puck.
Yep.
So, like, when the guy's coming in as a defender, and I see guys wave their stick around sometimes. Like, Johnny Gaudreau last night, it was funny. Soon as Connor Carrick moved his stick one way, that's when the puck went through because he read it perfectly. But if he just had his stick on that puck the whole time,
yep.
then maybe it's a little bit of a different play because you can follow the puck with the stick blade, correct?
That's perfectly described. And also, I'll say, if you could play a 2-on-1 perfectly, I'm playing against you guys right now. I'm kind of just making sure that you don't want to go over Jackie.
Right.
And then last minute, I'm there.
Get in on
and
it.
Right when you go to shoot. And that would be, you know, the perfect playing of 2-on-1. You didn't go down. You're able to have an active stick while also, you know, making sure the whole time you weren't thinking, all right, well, this is an easy play cross ice or through me. But, yeah, like I said, I was with Crosby in practice and Malkin, and you saw Gaudreau, and it doesn't matter what you do. If this is it, they're putting it right there.
They're going to find it.
It's nothing you can do. Something.
And that is what Larry Robinson used to tell the Devils when he was the assistant coach and head coach there. He would tell those defenders, the good players, even if you go down, they flip it over you. And then you're down, like to your point, you're in the corner.
No recovery.
You're out of the play, even if your goalie makes a save. Maybe it's a tap-in. So that's one of the things that I'm not a big fan of seeing guys go down, but some of the coaches teach it.
Yep.
And they like, and it also depends on righty lefty, right? Whether it makes sense to go down in a situation.
And offensively, the only thing I'll say is you got to shoot it sometimes. People want to make that perfect pass so often, but sometimes if you're a coach, you're sitting, how did you not shoot that? It was right there. So you can't try to pass too much, but the best in the game, they decide at the end what they want to do.
Fair enough. All right, good job, Witt. I've
Thank
never been on the demo rink with you
Thank
before.
Thank you.
Yeah. Nicely
this is my
done.
Setting. This is
I think you could. I think
rink.
You could handle us.
Oh, my. What is this?
Hump day.
One more time, Witt.
Hump day.
Very nice. You wondered who the voice was behind the scenes in those commercials.
Hump day.
There it is. There it is. Yeah, very nice.
Okay.
A man of many talents. I howl, he does the camel. You know.
Look on your face.
I'm the camel.
There you go. You are the camel.
I'll take it.
Yeah, why not?
Okay. The point of this segment is that since it's hump day, we're going to talk about what the bubble teams in the NHL need to do to get over the hump.
I get it.
And into the postseason. We will start.
All right.
I just hope Witt just does that hump day throughout the whole segment.
Yes, he will.
Okay, so Habs currently, as we look at the wild card standings here, they're on the outside looking in. What's the biggest thing they need to do to get over the hump?
They got to score some more goals, I think, and support Carey Price a little bit better, Whit. I mean,
yeah.
We know that Carey Price has the ability to keep them in games and make those critical saves, but they need support. They can't be hoping that Carey Price is going to shut everybody out. It's just not going to happen. So they need to get some offense. It'd be great if Jonathan Drouin could really get going now over the last dozen games or so.
Yeah, he had a run where he was playing the best hockey of his career, and I think that this isn't the best offensive team in the league, but they still have surprised a lot of people this year. I for one, thought they had no chance of making the playoffs. So I think they're on the right path, but like you said, you got to score more. Yeah. Price can only do so much, and they're solid, but you also look for them to add a little offense and help out the forwards in terms of, you know, scoring and joining the play, joining the rush. So a lot of good things to be done there that have been done, but I think there's more scoring that could maybe just be bared down on.
Well, you talk about needing to score more. It's a topic we talked a little bit about over the last week with the Columbus Blue Jackets, the team currently in that final wild card spot. What's the main thing they need to do to get over the hump and stay in a playoff spot?
Well, we just said scoring, and I think last night was a great start for them. And I think that 7 goals in a game is huge because they had 7 over the previous 6 games where they struggled. So I think that gelling together and really figuring out, you know, how the lines want to play with the new additions in Dzingel and Duchesne, who both scored last night, I believe, or both had points. So I think to get those guys more involved, get those people that they added at the deadline really in the mix, and also for Bobrovsky to play solid because, you know, he's one of their best players, and there's times he's been inconsistent. So if he could really buckle down and be that Vezina winning goalie that we've seen in the past, I think they have a great chance of getting in.
And, you know, it shouldn't go overlooked that he did play in these back-to-backs. He played against the Islanders and then against the Bruins. He wasn't great against the Bruins, but he didn't need to be because they got a bunch of goals to support him. They got 3 more sets of back-to-back coming up. They've got 12 games left on the schedule, 8 on the road, and so it's going to be a challenge for them. But I still think they can get there. And they got to build off what they did in that game last night. Because you watched them last night, and then you watched them against the Islanders on Monday. They look like a totally different team. They just had a lot more energy. They were a lot more physical. They were really pushing the pace. They've got to play that way if they're going to get to the playoffs.
I agree. The one word I think of when I think of the Blue Jackets, chemistry. They have to find their chemistry and keep it consistent. All right, to the West we go. Here's a look at the wild card picture in the West. The Stars and Yotes currently holding the 2 wild card spots with the Wild and the Avs on the outside looking in. Let's start with the Coyotes. They just moved into that playoff spot after beating the Blues last night. For them, what is it? What do they need to get over the hump?
Well, I think they're going to have to get the great goaltending from Darcy Kuemper on most nights. I mean, that's why they're here. Look at the numbers. I mean, we talk a lot about different guys for the Vezina Trophy this year. I don't think anybody ever said the name Darcy Kuemper and Vezina Trophy in the same sentence, but I'll be the first.
Ayo.
He deserves at least consideration. I don't think he's going to get that. I don't think he's going to get nominated, to be quite honest. But you look at the numbers. He's played 44 games. He's been terrific this year. He was huge last night in that game. They've got a ton of injuries still, but they've got some players coming back in the lineup. We talked about Michael Grabner earlier. We talked to him. He's fast. He's experienced. Some of these other guys, Nestroza, a young player that's playing well. Maybe they can get Stepan back at some point. Galchenyuk's got to pick it up. But I think at the end of the day, they're going to really rely on Darcy Kuemper to get it done.
I agree. I think it's all about guys stepping up. And with injuries, you're put in a role that you maybe not wouldn't be in if the team was healthy. So with Derek Stepan out, probably another couple weeks at minimum, I think that you need guys to really step up. And, you know, I think of the name Alex Galchenyuk, who's had glimpses this year, moments this year where he's dominated. But they just need more consistency out of him and really kind of for him to find his game and be at the top of his game these last 13.
Have you been in a room, Whit, in your career where, like, I got to think in Arizona right now, they're like, nobody believes in us. Nobody thinks we're going to win. I mean, that's a powerful thing. Have you ever been in that situation, whether it be as a college player or in any of the teams you played on in your career?
I can't really think back because the teams that I said nobody believes in us, we were a bad team, you know. I will say, actually, in Anaheim, we were the 8th seed. We played San Jose, the 1 seed. We beat them. Mm-hmm. And I think going to that, it was, you know, I don't think anyone really thinks we can beat this team. And to have that pride in the locker room and guys really believing in each other and not worrying about what everyone else says, I think it's a huge help. And the Coyotes definitely have that going.
All right, let's get through one more here. Minnesota Wild, an interesting team. What do they need to get over the hump?
Well, they need a bunch of different things. They're going to need good goaltending. We've kind of said that in scoring is the most common theme, but they have, you know, Mikko Koivu's out. That's a tough loss, so it's another thing about guys stepping up in the terms of being injured, other key players being injured. And I think to score more goals is just huge for these guys. Sometimes they get in that boring style of play where they're kind of, you know, they're not necessarily trapping teams, but it's not the most exciting games, and that can be good for them. That can be what helps them win games, but they're still going to need to score and create a little bit more offensively, because sometimes it seems like it's really difficult for them to get goals and really produce. And so if they could open things up a little bit, I think it would help to try to just at least get some more odd man rushes, things like that, to create offense.
Play better at home. I mean, the Minnesota Wild used to be a team that you hated going into their place because they had that good crowd there, and it just seemed like they always were really good on home ice. And this year of late, they haven't been good on home, and they've got 7 of their last 12 on home ice in St. Paul, and you would think that'd be a plus. So they've got to be better on home ice, and to your point, too, you always need more offense. You know, Donato came in and really started putting up some points for them. Can he now continue? Is that little excitement, is that running out of gas? He needs to continue to produce. And they need their big guys in that lineup, Parisi, Staal, to kind of push forward and to make something happen. It's going to be tough. It's going to be a challenge in that Western Conference, because I think any of those teams that are in that bump can still get there.
I agree. It's going to be fun to watch, though, for us.
What segment was this?
Hump Day.
Hump Day?
Check with Mike Kelly. Let's start with the Flames, Mike. They certainly put on a show against the Devils last night. That might be an understatement, but tell us why they were so dominant in the offensive zone.
This was the biggest beating any team has given another team in a game all season. And it's not just the score. It's not just the 9 goals. Let's take a look at the high danger chances. Jackie, you know I love talking about it.
I know you do.
This is the inner slot. The inner slot, the most dangerous area on the ice. Half the goals in the league almost are scored from there. The Devils had 4 shots from there. That is not a lot. How many did the Calgary Flames have? Go to the other end of the rink. They had 18. And the ones with little orange circles around them are goals. And a lot of them are overlapped. It doesn't look like 18 because they're all in the same spot. 18. That's a lot. How many is it? Well, in terms of single game highs this season, Calgary ranks number 3. Third most high danger shots a team has put on net in a game this season. And again, New Jersey only had 4. So this was, from a goal scoring standpoint, from a scoring chances standpoint, the biggest beatdown of the season. Johnny Gaudreau, what did he have, 1 goal in his last 19 games? This guy must have had 5 breakaways last night. He was dialed in all over the ice, scores a hat trick, gets 6 points. How many shots did he have from that high danger inner slot area? Well, he had 7. Only one player has had more in a game all year, and it's his teammate Sean Monahan. It's usually Gaudreau setting up Monahan. It was the other way around last night. So from a team perspective, Calgary, an incredibly dominant performance, one of the most dominant we've seen all season by any team. And for Johnny Gaudreau, he talked before the game about, you know, I'm getting chances, the goals will start coming. Well, he was getting chances. He had a ton of chances in that game last night. So that just gives you a little bit of perspective, a little context into what an absolute beating it was.
Well, Mike, you know I love it when you bring the sweet spot stats into this segment, but can we talk about the graphics package for a second? Because it looks like you leveled up there a little bit this week.
Yeah, we bumped up a notch. We're gonna have more cool stuff coming. That's what I always say is, like, if you have great information, it's one thing. If you can present it really well, that's kind of the total package. So, it's a pretty cool way to look at things, I think, and hopefully give people a good understanding of what went down in that game if they didn't see it, because, like I said, that was a massacre.
Yeah, well, the new graphics package is a win. Very nice. Let's talk Ben Bishop. Got his 3rd straight shutout last night. Analytically, why do you think he's been so successful as of late?
Well, for Ben Bishop, the good thing for the Dallas Stars is they've been one of the best defensive teams in the league all season. I'm talking about limiting those high danger shots that you and I talk so often about. Ben Bishop's made 94 saves in the 3 games that he's got shutouts in, and the streak goes on a little longer than that. It's over 200 minutes. When I look at Ben Bishop, I see 2 things in this shutout streak, and we'll show you a graphic in a moment. Number 1, they have Dallas given up a lot of shots from real and tight. You see a cluster there by the net. These are all the shots he's faced during this shutout streak in the last 3 games. But you see the high slot. There's not a ton up by the top of the circles. And Dallas has done a really good job limiting shots from those areas, kind of from the hash marks up to the top of the circle. So for Ben Bishop, I mean, it's legit when you look at all the shots that have come his way from right in front of the net, right in front of his crease. But again, a testament to Dallas, who's a top 3 team this season and limiting high dangerous scoring chances overall. They've been really keeping that high slot area clear and helping him out. So if he has a if he goes into his next game and pitches a shutout in the first period, it'll be the longest streak in Dallas Stars history, passing Eddie Belfour, the great Eddie Belfour. So yeah. That's great stuff for Ben Bishop.
Eddie the Eagle. Everybody loves him. All right, let's talk Sharks. They get the victory against the Jets with a stunning game winner from Joe Pavelski last night. How did they get such a prime opportunity so late in the game?
Well, so this is a tough one. First, I want to talk a little bit about Nick Ehlers, the guy who made the pass that we're going to show in a second. Now, he made a pass that he said after. He said today, you know, it was a stupid play, and you'll see it coming up right here. There's 8 seconds left in the game. He goes for the home run play to Andrew Kopp for a one-timer. If that pass goes in, it's game over for Winnipeg. But you see the stick right there. That's Marc-Edouard Vlasic breaking that pass up. He's had an up-and-down season, but that was such a great play by him, and it sets forth the two-on-one the other way, and now San Jose wins it with just seconds left. So I know Ehlers was saying, yeah, it wasn't the right play given the state of the game, and he's right. Kopp was smacking his stick on the ice, though. He wanted that pass, and if they connect, Winnipeg probably wins the game. Vlasic, you take a look at where he ranks in the NHL in block passes in the defensive zone. He's tied for 22nd in the league for a game with Matthias Ekholm and with Victor Hedman, two very good all-around and defensive defensemen. So I know it's been a bit up and down for Vlasic, but that stick check, that block pass, sorry, that he had right there was just a phenomenal play by him to read that play and know that Kopp was there setting up for a one-timer. So on the one hand, you've got Ehlers trying to make a play that was a little too risky given the state of the game. But on the other hand, that two-on-one doesn't happen if it's not for Vlasic, who does what he's done so often this season, which is make a really nice play with his stick.
I'll tell you what, I'd love to see the Sharks and Jets meet up in the postseason. That'd be a great series.
Totally, totally. It'd be fantastic. And Winnipeg gives up a lot of chances, and San Jose creates a ton. The goaltending in San Jose has been kind of average all year. You can poke a few holes on both sides, but it seems like whenever they play, the games are super exciting. So yeah, you can dial me in for 7 of those. No problem.
Yeah, exactly. All right. Good stuff as always, Mike. We'll see you later.
All right. Thanks, Jackie.
Gregory in alone. Shoot, scores. Gregory, big bone to the backhand. Brought his forehand, and he went up to the top shelf.
And the goal is down there, and he scores. And they celebrate the tying goal. Quick hands by Worella, and he dances back.
Kopp scores, first shot on goal, and he makes no mistake.
The Ball Hockey World Championships will be taking place in June over in Slovakia, and two of the gentlemen that will be representing Team USA are with us right now, Bobby Hauser and Johnny Ruiz. Thanks, guys, for taking the time to be with us today, and let's start, Bobby. This will be your 6th World Championships of ball hockey?
Yeah. It's, I'm only 30, but like I found out today when one of the producers was showing me, they put like the 3-0.
Yeah.
This makes me feel really old, and I didn't like that. And then I found out about it was my 6th. I didn't know that either, and I'm like, oh, that's awesome.
Well, you're doing good, and you're young. When you get to my age, you'll have a lot more worries, believe me. Right. And Johnny, this is your third,
yes,
opportunity, right? So give the viewers a little bit of a background of ball hockey, because our fans are always watching NHL games, they're watching ice hockey. You guys have played ice hockey. What's the difference?
Running. A lot that's of where running. It's big, you know, big rink, just like ice hockey, but way more running than you like. It's tough on your knees, but it's good time.
Are they like the same penalties that they call in ice hockey, or are there different penalties that are just in ball hockey, or is it like, you know, tripping's tripping, but is there anything else?
Yeah, it's the same.
Yeah,
pretty much the same.
Yeah.
And you guys play on a international surface, so it's 200 by 100, which is a lot of running. What's the roster like? What are the shifts like? Because again, there's no gliding when you're running. You got to keep moving. No. So what's an average shift length, let's say?
30, 40 seconds, I don't know. Maybe.
Maybe a little less, depending
on.
So it's quick.
Depending on the time of the game.
Well, we'll go down to their zone, but we just don't back check, so you get off.
You race to the bench.
Yeah. It's all about avoiding the back check in ball hockey, I feel.
Well, it's kind of like the NHL for some teams.
Yeah,
not
exactly.
All.
For some players,
for some players, exactly. How many guys are on the bench? Is there 18 skaters?
Yeah,
or
pretty much the same.
Runners?
4 full lines, you know. We just carry 6, 7, D, 2 goalies normally, but sit pretty much the same as ice.
And then how did you two guys get into playing ball hockey? I mean, I know you both played ice hockey in college, but I'm wondering where the transformation happened.
My father is pretty big into
He's a big star, yeah. Right? Yeah, he's like the face legend. Of U.S. Yeah. ball hockey, right?
So
Chris,
your
dad's name, Chris Hauser.
Yes, so I was pretty much born into it, and then I just really liked it. I wasn't really good until I was like 17, okay. So I didn't really expect to play like anything competitive. And then one day I just got pretty okay, and then I was like, this is
I would
fun.
Say pretty okay. When you're going to go to your sixth world championships, yeah, I would say you're pretty okay,
I'd take
right?
being pretty okay.
Yeah. Pretty okay. Did you watch your dad? Like, you must have watched your dad play this growing up, right?
He was near the end of his career when I first actually started watching the game, like following him and all that. But in 2007, we were in Germany, and USA had like a little bit of a roster confliction. Uh-huh. So he decided to take me at 18 when I was way too young, and there was like three injuries, so he had to play.
Okay.
And playing with him was the worst, because it was just like him yelling at me to get the ball, and yelling at me to pass him the ball, and he'll shoot, and then he'll yell at me to get the ball again.
Yeah.
But it was that was awesome to play with him, and we didn't do that good that tournament, but it was still fun.
I heard that he played against there was the player who plays for the Vancouver Canucks, who played for the Vancouver Canucks recently, Alex Burrows. What was that? Because he was apparently a really good ball hockey player as well.
Yeah, he was in his 50s when that happened.
Your dad was in his 50s. Yeah.
And Burrows was still young. I don't even know. He might have maybe a year in the NHL or something.
Yeah.
But
he got under people's skin on the ice. Did he do it on the court?
I think he said some things to my father, which I don't really want to say on because it's not a good look.
Well, as
for
long
anybody.
As he didn't bite him, yeah, we're okay.
No, yeah. But so my father was able to play so long because he's really good at faceoffs. Like I still can't beat him, and he's 64.
Wow.
It's like it's not fun.
Is that a big thing in ball hockey? Maybe more than ice
getting
hockey, even to having that control of the ball.
Definitely getting possession after faceoff. Yeah. Huge power plays. You know, if you're killing in your zone, you want to get that first. You know.
Why? Possession. Why is it so much more different? Like, as hockey, you win faceoffs important, but in ball hockey, it sounds like you guys are telling us that it's more important.
Sort of like soccer, I guess, in a way. You know, like it's all about ball possession. Some teams dump and chase, but you get so tired.
You know,
having the ball on your stick more than not having it is generally the better way to go about it.
So I'm wondering, I see the gloves here. Obviously, they're not hockey gloves. Those are still protective enough in terms of like getting a slash and stuff?
Yeah, yeah.
That's crazy, because they don't look like I guess they're easier to probably handle the stick, but just as protective. Yeah. Imagine those things on the ice, EJ?
No.
I could have used those.
Yeah, yeah. You could use about 5 minutes until they got slashed off your hands.
Yeah.
Interesting. I mean, it's so interesting to think the differences. The sports are the same, but yet they're so dramatically different. And, you know, Johnny, both of you guys have played both. How did you make the transition? Obviously, Bobby's dad was involved with it. How did you make that?
Well, I started playing in, like, town rec leagues around, and then they started, you know, making a tournament team, you travel around for that. And then I switched, I played street hockey first, so then I went and started playing ice hockey and then just kept going as it, you know, but.
Well, more so to do with your team currently. I mean, you guys have, I think you're 12-0-2 in your last 14 world championship games, so you're going into this summer confident. What are you kind of looking to do for this tournament? And then also, like, how many round robin games are there? How many games do you have in the first round, or how does that work?
Four.
You want to, I don't know.
Yeah, there's normally four.
You just show up to the games?
You play pretty much your whole bracket or your whole pool once, and then you go from there, so.
And tell us some of the people at home, some of the countries that have teams that you would never even think of in terms of hockey.
India,
England, Pakistan.
Cayman Islands.
Bermuda. That's crazy.
Bermuda, Haiti.
No need for ice.
Nope.
You can play anywhere, so that's why you have a lot of the warm weather places that can be involved in a sport like this. Who are the powerhouse? We see it on the screen. It looks like Slovakia is the team to beat, and they're hosting this World Championships coming up.
They won the last three World Championships, so they're good. Czechs always have a great team. Canada, unbelievable. So just those are the big three, and we're trying to get our names back into that mix of that.
Why are the Slovaks so good? Like, what is it about the way they play that makes them a powerhouse?
They are all like 6'4" built.
Really?
And they're just like, they play a trap game for the most part.
Okay.
So when you're playing the trap, obviously you have to attack them, and our game's speed, and they shut that down, so they beat us. They shut Canada down, they beat them, and so on and so forth. They're just really well coached, honestly.
There's hitting, right?
In the corners you can. Okay. Like it gets
probably hard to hit guys open.
Yeah, you can't open.
You don't have that open ice hit.
No, but it's physical for sure.
Oh yeah. And then last thing I'm wondering is, I mean, obviously not a puck, the ball, but with how much this spins, can you actually like use that while you're shooting it, try to like spin it more? Is it, you know?
Oh, yeah, when you shoot, it could curve on you.
Can you do that?
You can definitely add that to that where puck normally doesn't do that.
Yeah.
But
awesome. You get a little spin on it.
I know, a little English there. I like it. Well, guys, listen, thanks for coming in today and best wishes over there in Slovakia in June. I believe it's June 14th that it starts. When you win the gold, come back. We'll have a little party here. You can tell us about all the good things, but go get them.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
All right. Thanks a lot. Good luck to you guys.